Ah, ah, that's an effort.
Shadowverse. Greetings, I'm Shad. And whenever most people think of what the medieval bow is, one that comes to their mind is this bow right here, the longbow. And I've certainly been guilty of that in amplifying the longbow's prominence. And it really is. Think about, what is the medieval bow? It's always the longbow. Think about medieval archery. What are the archers using? They're going to be longbows. So much so that the longbow now just seems to be the default medieval bow, to the point that some people don't even know that there was actually another very common bow used all throughout the medieval period. In actual fact, it predates the medieval period. And that is this bow right here, the short recurve bow. The misconception that people have is to assume that any type of bow that is of this shape is an Asiatic style bow. Now, very prominent in Asia, but not just in Asia. The shorter recurve bow was used all throughout the medieval period. And I've got heaps of artwork, direct primary sources showing that this style of bow right here was used massively in the medieval period. And really short, full recurves as well. And the idea that this style of bow originated only in Asia and is only represented or primarily used in Asia is utterly incorrect. Indeed, when you look at the type of bows the Romans were using, guess what? They are shorter styled recurve bows. So these bows predate the medieval period. And the idea that Europeans just forgot how to make or even use these bows after the fall of Rome, and that's a kind of a misconception. Rome still existed. They just lost control over the further areas of their empire, but Rome was still around and existed into the medieval period. But in any regard, their technology stayed around, and of course, even the types of bows that Romans and other people used throughout the world still stuck around. And so this short recurve style bow, absolutely, as you're seeing the references here, is very prominent in the medieval period. And the idea that medieval people just use longbows and these style bows just come from Asia is a massive misconception. And as I've mentioned, I've even helped spread that misconception, but I'm clearing that up now because as I looked into it, because I was starting to ask questions about it myself.
I've just noticed something very cool while editing this video. It's a short recurve bow, strung, and it is being held within a quiver. I've come across this idea before. It's just really cool to find it confirmed in a direct historical medieval source.
Well, I knew that Romans used recurve bows, and so where did, and so I decided to actually look into direct sources. All right, let's look at all the types of bows that are being represented in medieval art. And oh my goodness, short recurves, they're everywhere. Now, of course, longbows are everywhere too, but it just shows they used both. Each type of bow has their strengths and weaknesses. And I'm going to talk about more primarily in this video, the unique benefits and strengths of this style of bow. And there's going to be another video I'm making after this one talking about the unique differences, strengths, and also weaknesses of the longbow. Because there is so much to just talk about this one bow in and of itself, it's better to split it up and we're just going to be focusing on this short recurve style bow. In what capacities were they employed and used? What strength and power did they reach? Where does this, you know, reproduction come from? And many other things as well. I might even do a comparison shooting of this bow. This is my new one compared to my 100-pound longbow. Now this bow right here is 110 pounds. It's even higher poundage. Like, just compare that. This tiny little bow is more powerful than this massive longbow, because that's one of the first misconceptions we'll address. Little bow does not mean weaker, okay? This is such a misconception, and it's very much propagated by Dungeons & Dragons, the whole longbow, shortbow comparison. The shortbows in D&D all do less damage, and that is utterly wrong, okay? You can actually get insanely high-powered shortbows and very weak longbows. You can get longbows that are just like 40 pounds, really, really weak. And then there is another massive misconception that is propagated by Dungeons and Dragons, but also other fantasies as well, in regards to bows, and that is the composite bow. And composite simply means made out of a composite of materials, a combination of materials, laminated. This is a laminated bow. And guess what? This longbow is technically a composite one as well. It's laminated. Do you see the different color in the middle? It has a different type of wood snabbaged and glued together. It's not what you call a self bow. A self bow is a bow that's made out of one complete piece of wood. Like this longbow right here. Don't be fooled by the different colors. This is actually the sapwood and heartwood of yew. Another name for this type of bow is a bear bow because it is a bare piece of wood, nothing else, all right? There's no arrow rest or anything. And this is what most traditional longbows were like. They were self bare bows, by themselves, not laminated. But I'm just saying to point out, you can absolutely make laminated or composite longbows that are weaker in poundage than a self. This one is 130 pound. The laminated longbow I have, the composite one, is 100 pounds, all right? So the idea that composite or laminated bows are inherently superior or higher poundage is false. And the idea that shorter, smaller bows are always lower poundage is also utterly incorrect. There is a significant difference though in another parameter, and it's not in terms of size, short bow versus long bow, composite versus self bow, but something that you might notice, and that is recurve versus no recurve. This bow has a single deflex. It's a single flex on the limbs, where a recurve has a deflex and a reflex, hence recurve. And recurve bows have very interesting and special benefits. There's a reason why they reflexed the tips. Guess what? Again, the idea that only short bows are recurve bows is incorrect. Not only absolutely can you have recurved long bows, they did it historically. Here is a reference right here of artwork showing a recurved long bow. They exist, and they existed historically as well. So the idea that every short bow is a recurve bow, and the idea that every long bow is a non-recurve bow, that's also false. But there is a bias in each category. Most short bows are recurved, usually because of the size and design. I'll talk about that a little bit later. And most long bows are not recurved, even though you can, because on long bows, it's not necessary. Reflexing the tips will increase the poundage of a bow by a little bit. But you know another way to increase the poundage of the bow? Just get stiffer wood or make it a little bit thicker, and you don't have to go to the trouble of steaming and reflexing the limbs. And it's a lot of trouble. It's a very specific fine-tuning kind of process that you need to know the right techniques. And it's just easier to make it a little bit thicker, and you get the higher poundage out of it anyway. Well, then why don't you make shorter bows thicker? Well, it goes into interesting physical things that arise from them literally being shorter. Again, we're going to talk a bit about it, but before we get there, I want to talk about the name of this style of bow, because there is a very common name that is used to refer to this bow or these styles of bows, and it's horse bows. And I personally hate that name. Now, there are some names that were not used historically that are perfectly fine in the modern day, and we've just learnt to live with them, like broadsword. People often refer to this style of sword as a medieval broadsword, but it doesn't necessarily spread anything incorrect. I mean, this style of sword is broader than, say, rapiers, even though historically broadsword refers to a Scottish basket-hilted broadsword, and I need to use that prefix because the terminology has just changed in modern language so much that if I say broadsword, people don't think I'm referring to a Scottish basket-hilted broadsword. They think I'm referring to this, a medieval arming sword. The thing that actually makes it more okay is they refer to it as a medieval broadsword. And so you can't misidentify me calling a medieval broadsword as a Scottish basket-hilted broadsword, because that's not a medieval sword, it's a Renaissance sword. And so in any context that you can even try and understand, if I say medieval broadsword, you know I'm referring to the arming sword right here. And you're not actually spreading any misinformation per se. But when we come to horse bow, that's completely different. You are spreading misinformation by the concept and idea that these style of bows were primarily used on horseback. Now, of course, they were used on horseback. They were used on horseback in the medieval period as well by medieval soldiers. But not only on horseback, they were used on foot a lot. And from on sieges into castle defense and attacking castles and everything like that. And so by calling these horse bows, it's primarily propagating the idea that this is not only a bow that's meant to be used on horseback, but that other bows are not meant to be used on horseback, which is also incorrect, because the longbow was also used on horseback. References right here. My clothes has even recreated and done this on horseback to show it can be done, and it can be done. Longbows can be used on horseback. The idea that short recurve bows are the only bow on horseback, no. And so the name horse bow, I personally hate. These are not horse bows. In actual fact, there's a very obvious, simple answer to identify what this bow is. In contrast to other types of bows, we have longbow, and it's what I've been calling it. It's a short bow. It's that simple. And you can use the default that when you refer to short bow without any other thing, you're referring to a recurve bow, because yes, short bows are more often recurved. And when you refer to the longbow, you're referring to them not being recurved. And if you get one out of the ordinary, which they did exist, where a longbow was recurved, you would call it a recurve longbow. And if you refer to a short bow that actually isn't recurved, you would call it a decurve short bow. It's that simple. And so just by the basic designation, short bow, done, easy, problem solved. No misinformation. These are obviously short bows by their very design and shape and appearance. Look, that's what they are. So then why are most short bows recurved? Well, it comes out of a necessity of the design. Compare these two bows, okay? To reach full draw on either one of these bows, because this one is shorter, the limbs by necessity will need to curve more. And at the end of the draw, the tips of the short bow are actually going to be more angled towards the archer, which can increase the likelihood of the string pulling off. The way you fix that is you just reflex the tips, bringing it up. That will help house the string. Now compare it. Have a look at how much these limbs bend comparison to the short bow. So to do this at full draw, like so, the limbs, like, they bend, but not in an excessive amount. But compare that to the level that these limbs need to bend to reach full draw on this one. All right, and I can't even... That's not too bad, actually. It's a tough bow still. And this bow is made to be pulled back another inch or two than I was able to get it. And you can imagine, if there was no deflex on this type of bow, and the string was just brought here and you're pulling back, this limb, if this was the end of the bow, would curve down almost horizontal at some points, which gives a dangerous chance of the string pulling off. There are, of course, other advantages to having a reflex design like this. And you can get short bows that are not reflexed. It just helps, okay? Makes it a bit more secure. And of course, like I said, other advantages that I'll talk about. So I really want to emphasize one of the things I've already talked about, but just round it off now, and that is the comparison between short bow and long bow. One is not inherently more powerful than the other. There is references of short bows, and this reference actually comes from Asiatic sources, because it's hard to find information on medieval style short bows. I do have information to share, but it's really hard to find. And in regards to the highest poundages that shorter recurve bows could reach, there's more reliable information from Asiatic sources, this one technically comes from China, that they could reach beyond 200 pounds. The thing is though, that is a difficult feat to achieve. It needs to be laminated in that case, usually with horn and sinew combined with the wood, glued together. It's a difficult process, more difficult than making a self bow. And you can make a bow of that level poundage easier. I'm not saying it is easy, in comparison it is easier to make a higher poundage self bow than a composite one, but there is a unique problem with that. And it's that exact same thing that I mentioned before. To get full draw on a shorter bow, because they're shorter, the limbs need to curve more. To make a higher poundage bow, you need to make the limbs more resistant to flex. The more it flexes then, the higher chances it has to break. And because short bows need to flex more to reach full draw, they have a higher chance to break than long bows. The way that you fix that is by making them out of laminated material. That makes them be able to curve more, because by necessity they must, and not break nearly as much. So if you want to save the trouble of making a laminated, complex construction like this, but still get a very high-powered bow, just a self-bow, more often than not, and this is shown by history, it's more reliable to make the limbs longer so they don't need to bend as much, which reduces the chance of them breaking. And then you can make it stiffer, and as a result, it's going to be a longer bow. This is why longbows are stereotypically identified as being high poundage. Not that every longbow was, or that every short bow wasn't high poundage, but you can make a high pound longbow easier. It's not to say it is easy, it's just easier to make in comparison to a complex laminated construction, shorter recurve. And it goes into that necessity reason before. There is not as much of a necessity to need to make longbows laminated, a composite of multiple materials, because they didn't need to, the limbs don't need to bend as much. There's less risk of them breaking, and you can just make them thicker to reach the higher poundage. So it's actually a really interesting comparison when you actually start to study and figure out why are these bows made the way they are. And as a result, Most longbows, not laminated self bows, but more often short bows, are laminated composite construction. And this comes back to the whole role-playing D&D point. Please, if you want to make your settings more realistic, throw away that dumb D&D rule that short bows are weaker, long bows are better, and composite ones are better. Like, it's just, it's dumb, okay? The power of a bow is more largely determined by the poundage, all right? There is a difference in recurve. Recurve usually does increase the power, but again, you can save yourself all the trouble of making a recurve by just making the bow a little bit thicker, and you get the high poundage anyway, though there is a unique additional benefit that the recurve does, and it seems that recurve bows release the energy when you actually release the arrow and it shoots. They contract, okay? They're releasing the energy in a more efficient and faster manner. So usually, and it does seem like this, I've been looking at it multiple sources, and it seems that the consensus is a recurve of the same poundage as a longbow, so say they're both 100 pound equal, will actually propel arrows a little bit more powerfully, a little bit faster than the longbow due to the recurve benefits. It releases the energy a little bit better. But do you know how you can compensate and get that back on the longbow? Just make the longbow a little bit more powerful, like another 5-10 pounds, and you'll probably match the advantage that the recurve has. And you don't need to go to the trouble of making such a complex construction or actually steaming the limbs to put a recurve, you know, shape in the wood. And you just get a little bit stronger and you can hack it, handle it, okay? So that's actually a really interesting comparison, and a lot of people just misunderstand it. And so, fix your D&D games or your role-playing games or everything. The power or damage of the bow should be determined by the poundage, not the size. So when doing the research and realizing that short bows were far more prominent in the medieval period than even I had assumed, I knew they existed, but they're everywhere, okay? I had to get my hands on one. In fact, I wanted to get one that was representative of a lot of these bows that I was seeing in the artwork. And I looked online and I could not find anything that were making these style of bows in the poundage I was after, and that was 100 pounds plus, okay? This one is 110 pounds. I couldn't find anyone anywhere doing short medieval styled recurve bows of that poundage. And it goes again into the misconception that a lot of people just seem to think that they weren't common or they just didn't exist, because I found a decent, it was a lot easier to find Asiatic, Mongolian style short recurve bows of the, you know, levels that I was after. I found this bow here, and this one is actually decently representative of medieval style ones. The tips, at first I thought not so much, because I thought these tips were a bit more Asiatic in style. If you have a look, see the tip here? But guess what? Look at this medieval artwork right here. That, like, there's a misconception idea that these kind of, you know, bow tips, see how it's a bit flatter on the side here? Is a more Asiatic design, but it's in medieval art. We had these styles of bows in medieval Europe as well. And so this one is actually more representative of a medieval recurve than even I had assumed, but it's only 30 pounds. And this didn't even come close to the poundage that I really wanted, which was the war bow category. And here's another misconception to clear up. Some people, I've even had commenters on my own videos, state that it needs to be a longbow to be a warbow. That's incorrect. No, a warbow is defined by the poundage, not the actual size. This bow right here, see this tiny little recurve, is a warbow. I've already shown you, it's a higher poundage than my 100 pound longbow. It's 110 pounds. And it's so small. It's beautiful. Man, I love how, I'll tell you where I got this in a sec. But 110 pounds. That's amazing and also astounding for such a small bow. So the idea that short bows are only like 30 pounds, and look, this bow is smaller than this one, okay? Yet this one kicks the absolute crap in power out of it. This is only 30 pounds. It's 110. It's amazing, right? So looking online for ages, coming up short, I decided to reach out to a great YouTuber that I've been in contact with, and his name is Jack from the YouTube channel Historical Archery. I really encourage you to go check out Jack's channel, subscribe if you haven't. He's always testing out new bows, doing reviews, but also making videos on about historical archery. It's brilliant, please check it out. And I sent Jack an email saying, mate, I'm looking for a medieval style recurve, I can't find anything. And Jack was able to point me in the right direction, and he sent a couple of sources, one of them being MR Bows. And going to MR Bows, I found the exact designs I was looking for. At first, the type of bow that I like, because when you look up short recurve, it's all Asiatic Mongolian style short recurves. I couldn't find anything that was medieval style, and the closest that I could find was the Scythian bow, but nothing in the draw ranges that I really wanted. But going to MR Bows, I found his Despot model right here. And his Despot model is based off of an image that is on the mural of a Serbian church, okay? So these Serbian churches have these beautiful old murals, and these are old churches, right? They come from the period. So it's based off of a direct source. Now, if you think that this is only a Serbian style bow, then no, because looking at this style bow, I've been able to confirm that, like in this shape, like look at the rounded tips as well, in multiple medieval artworks. So that his Despot model is actually very representative of what many medieval recurve bows were like. And when I saw that, I was like, yes! Take my money now, right? And it is beautiful. So if you're interested in medieval recurve bows of like high poundage, MR Bows is the place to go. One of the only guys I've been able to find who make short medieval style recurves, because yes, it's a medieval style bow. And so when we think of like the medieval archer, I really want to start to shift the image of them always holding a longbow. No. They also hold these bows. I've been looking at the reference and images that have been flashing up through this whole video, all right? They're everywhere. All right, now let's talk about drawaways. We've already mentioned that it is wholly inaccurate to assume short bows are just weaker in poundage. No, that's wrong, okay? And from the artwork references we see, these bows were absolutely used in warfare. So that means we can very logically conclude that the short medieval recurve bows did come in the war bow weight category and ranges, all right? And when we say what the war bow weight categories are, 70, more commonly 100 pound minimum. And they go all the way up to a maximum of 200 pounds. Now, there is no mechanical limitation that prevents short bows, even made traditionally, from being made up to 200 pounds draw category. We do not have any historical finds that show this bow's actually got, unlike the Mary Rose finds where we actually have more reliable evidence to say these longbows did reach to 200 pound category, but there's no mechanical limitation preventing it, but they are harder to make. It would be much harder to make a 200 pound short bow compared to a 200 pound longbow. That's just a self bow, okay? A bare self bow, single bit of wood, limbs don't need to flex as much, so it's safer, less chance of breaking, stuff like that. To be able to make a short bow in that range, absolutely it would need to be laminated, and there's even a higher chance of breaking, but that's why you make them laminated to reduce those chances and all those things, but it's a difficult process. And this is why this MR bow, and I should have mentioned, I'll mention it now, actually has fiberglass on the outside and inside instead of like traditional horn or sinew or something like that, because it's a lot more reliable, all right? And easy to make a higher pounded short bow by using fiberglass composite instead of wholly traditional materials. Using wholly traditional materials, yeah, it's a much more difficult process. It can be done, just much more difficult to be able to make a short bow up to 200 pounds, but that doesn't mean every war bow was 200 pounds, no. And most archers, most actual combat war archers would not be shooting 200 pounds. That's the high, exceptional, very rare range that few people would reach, okay? Most archers would be shooting between 100 to 140 pounds in the warbow range, and that's hard enough, right? And in those ranges, you definitely have the power and range that you would want your military archers to be able to shoot at. So to cite some direct references, this was originally published as part of the Practical Guide to Manchu Military Archery, the Journal of Chinese Martial Studies, Winter 2012. Bows were graded by strength from 3, which equates to about 40 pounds, to as high as 18, which is 240 pounds, according to their stiffness. And so they had like their own category system from 3 to 18, which was a stiffness category, and equating it to pounds, was between 40 to 240 pounds. And this is looking at short recurves. But the reason why this is informative, it shows that even traditionally made, short recurve bows can absolutely be made up to some crazy high poundage. This reference says 240 pounds. The ability at strength of 6, which was about 80 pounds, was considered the minimum for a grown man. That makes sense. I would agree with that. I could draw an 80-pound bow without training. I've done archery my whole life, but my average was just sitting on 40 pounds, and then I picked up an 80-pound bow, and I was able to draw it without any additional training. I had to train to get up to 100 pounds, but this absolutely is reflected in my own anecdotal experience as well. The strength of 10, which is 133 pounds, was required for participation in hunts. So that is definitely war bow ranges. Short recurve style bows, absolutely in the war bow ranges. I found some more references that place the Mongolian recurve bow at an average max. So the average maximum poundage was around 166 pounds. The true average would be around 100 and 120 pounds. Not the average max, just the average baseline. So yes, we have references that recurve laminated bows traditionally made can absolutely be made in war bow ranges, all right? And because we are seeing medieval artwork of these bows being shot in battle and warfare, absolutely, these bows are war bow ranges. In the war bow category, they're not going to be light hunting bows. So once again, the misconception that short bows are weak is wrong. There's another misconception that people then get confused a bit. And I've had comments saying this just in the video where I was behind the scenes vlog, just joking around, trying to figure out how to learn how. I can do it myself now. Do you see the intro? I can string this myself. It's an effort, right? But saying that because I have this bow, I should switch to thumb draw. Now, thumb draw is great, but the idea that thumb draw is preferable to short recurve bows is wrong. You can absolutely shoot these shorter recurve bows with a 3-finger Mediterranean grip. I've shot this one with it. It actually shoots beautifully. I might even do one or two shots just at the end of this to see what ranges we can get out of it. But medieval archery was a diverse thing. They shot in many ways, but the most common way, of course, was the Mediterranean grip. We see it reflected in the artwork and in conjunction with short recurve bows. So to say that thumb draw is the one you should use with short, no, that's wrong, okay? It depends on style. If you want to practice Mongolian style archery, well, you do the traditional way that they usually do, thumb draw. But if you want to do the more traditional European style of shooting, usually it's 3-finger Mediterranean grip. You can still do, and 2 fingers, Mediterranean, like that's still Mediterranean. Either side of the bow. We see it in medieval art, all right? And they had multiple stances and ways of drawing the bow as well. There's actually some, it's a diverse and awesome, really interesting thing to get into. But because short recurve bows are not wholly Asiatic or Mongolian or anything, they're also European medieval, that means it is not wrong to shoot Mediterranean style with this style of bow at all. And I'm not saying you should do what you like, okay? What tradition that you want to practice, if you want to get into historical archery, what you enjoy. I prefer 3-finger because it's easier to draw heavier bows with 3 fingers on 3 joints than the thumb draw, which is on 1 joint. It can be done. I mean, Jack already mentioned him from historical archery. He's able to shoot some impressively high poundage bows with thumb draw, but he also mentions it hurts, okay? It's not a wholly comfortable thing doing thumb draw, and so I definitely just feeling the pressure. Like if I practice and train, maybe I could do it. But my goodness, one of the things that people don't talk about in terms of strain of these heavy bows, they mention shoulder strain, muscle strain, everything. You know, one of the biggest strains I've experienced in shooting war bows, it's on the finger joints. All right, actually getting strain on the finger joints from just drawing and pulling. In fact, I've only ever had one injury, and it was a tendon pull, I think, off which finger? I think it was on that finger. Only injury I've had, all right? Nothing on the shoulders, nothing on the muscles or anything. It's been finger joints. And so I get enough strain. And yeah, I much prefer Mediterranean, thanks, because it's just easier. One of the obvious advantages of a shorter recurve bow is that they're lighter, all right? And if a bow is lighter, it's easier to keep steady when you're shooting it. And a more steady bow means more accurate. There are really great advantages to these style of bows. And being shorter, they're just more convenient to move, carry around and everything. And it's funny, when people saw me grabbing this bow and showing it, they said, Shad, you should remake your shooting from a tree video, because one of the takeaways of can you shoot a bow from a tree was how much the limbs got tangled in the leaves because of how big the longbows were that I was using. Now, I did mention already in that video that using this bow was far more convenient, because I had this bow at the time, because it was a shorter bow. And this one is even shorter. So obviously there are a lot of convenience about having a smaller bow. And one of the things that would make this bow really more useful is in sieges, from castle battlements specifically. By having a smaller bow, you can get up to the battlement and move around and even shoot between the merlons, so you know, the crenellations, and even shooting down through, yes, machicolations. We'll save the shout for special times, okay, but we know I love them, all right? But absolutely, smaller bows, more convenient to shoot through battlements and through machicolations, and we see it in art. We see these bows used in from medieval sieges in defense and also attack. Now, it's obvious these bows were very prominent. I hope I've been able to show plenty of evidence to establish that as a fact. But where, all right? Because it does seem that their prominence differed from region. And the longbow is so iconically tied to medieval England specifically. One of the things that I've found online, I've been able to substantiate this because I don't have a traditionally made composite recurve bow to test this. This is made out of with modern glue, it's got modern fiberglass, so it's very sturdy and it's a brilliant bow, but a traditional one is made out of traditional composite material, so we're looking at horn, sinew, and traditional glues. Well, the thing that I found online is that the glue can actually loosen in wetter climates, and we know it's much, much wetter in England and Britain, the whole British Isles, right, than mainland Europe. And the explanation was that these bows were more prominently represented in mainland Europe and less in Britain because of the climate difference. That could be true, but I haven't substantiated, so I'm not going to say it is an actual fact, because to my understanding, it was usual practice to avoid shooting in rain anyway. And you could, if you really wanted, have a composite laminated bow in, you know, Britain if you wanted, and you just needed to avoid using it in the wet, if using it in a wetter climate is as much of an issue as some of the references I found online were, because that it's not substantiated. So I'm just sharing it as a possibility. It's an interesting fact. It rings a bit true because there's logic to it, but that's something you would really want to confirm before you're saying yes, because obviously I think there were laminated recurves in England, as there were longbows in mainland Europe as well. To say that just the longbow is this English thing and no one, no. The longbow predates the English, and even people say it's the Welsh longbow. Even the Vikings had a type of longbow. If you're talking about a deflex bow with longer limbs that come up to yay height, it's not an English or Welsh invention. That type of bow is a type of bow that would have been made before. Like, the reflex bow is an evolution of the bow. So obviously the regular D-curve bow was the one that was made first, and then we figured out how to reflex the limbs. And bows go back a very long time. And so to say that a longbow is a Welsh or English invention is wrong. Maybe the more traditional type that was made out of yew with the heartwood and sapwood is a more British Isles development. I haven't been able to find references for it, but that's a greater possibility. But the idea that just a longbow, a deflex longer bow, is a Welsh or British invention. No, that's wrong. The bow is an ancient invention, okay? And if you have a bow, you have a deflex bow, and I'm sure someone made one that was particularly long. And so there we go, the medieval recurve. Let's bring it back into popularity, people. If you have, like, medieval reenactments, I want to see these more in medieval reenactments. Like, that's the other, because I should have mentioned this at the end, now at the end, right? But tell you what, if you really want to see how this misconception is being propagated, look at the prominence of the longbow in medieval reenactment compared to the short recurve, okay? When the short recurve bow is it's a medieval bow, right? So let's see it more in medieval fantasy, medieval reenactment, everything, because it's a brilliant bow. There's some great features about it. It's not an inherently weak one. In fact, let me shoot two arrows. And look, this is a more powerful bow, so of course it's just going to shoot further, but still, let's shoot some arrows. And I don't have my gloves, this is going to hurt. Whew. Ooh, bare fingers. Bare fingers, man. Oh boy, you feel the heat on that. Oh man, I probably survived one more, but that hurt. Oh, ow! I don't have my glasses. I can't even see where the other arrow is.
Went far.
Ow! Oh.
Yeah, that even went... Yeah. Just starting to get a blister. No more. Use gloves. The medieval recurve bow. Let's bring it back into popularity. Thank you for watching. I hope you have enjoyed. And of course, I hope to see you on the next video. Keep an eye out for the video I'm going to be doing on the longbow in comparison to, say, other types of bows. I hope to see you there. And until that time, farewell. This is Oz stringing a 30-pound recurve. Step through with that leg, in between, so over.
Okay.
All right, here.
Okay.
Look. Are you okay?
I think something hit me.
It's a day.
Chad's massive hunk of wood just hit me right in the head.
Yeah, I know. My massive shaft just nearly knocked you out. So, you step through that way. Yeah.
Okay. So with this leg I step
yep,
over?
Yep,
okay.
In between that, and then hook that. Yep.
Okay.
There.
Oh, get it right up in my nads.
You don't need to go so high on this one because it's smaller. Wait. Yeah, is that on? It's not on the other end. You let it go off on the other end.
Wait, I can fix this. Now it's on.